IRS on the Road, value-based parenting and life balance ideas from world-traveling family coaches. Here's Richard and Linda Iyer.
Well, hello. We are back with IRS on the Road. We're always happy to be with you. We're so grateful for those of you who take the time to listen and comment once in a while. We feel like we're just talking to a computer, but we know there are a few of you out there.
We try to see your faces out there, and Merry Christmas season to you all, and be careful. This is going to be one of the strangest Christmases ever for some of us, but if we can just get through this holiday season, Linda, and if we can stay safe and keep our families safe, and especially keep all of your grandparents safe, we'll get through this year and a new year will start, and I don't think anyone is going to be too sad to say goodbye to 2020.
No, I don't either, but I'm starting to panic a little bit because I can see a glimmer of light at the end of the tunnel, and I'm starting to think, wait, did I do everything I could have? I mean, I've done a lot of stuff as
you mean,
you
did
have.
You appreciate
it? Did I appreciate the time that I had? Do I appreciate the internet enough? Yes, we do appreciate the internet enough because that's our way of communication. But, wow, you know, it is a moment in time, but we will get past this.
Well, and I think it's what you say is really important, Linda. People who just say, oh, I just want to be back to normal. I just want to get back to where we were before March came up and before we had all these issues and before the pandemic. And I think we should want something more than that. I think we should want to get through it, but to come out better and more appreciative and more aware of ourselves and to have done some reflection and some readjusting. And I think for many people, that's how it'll be. So as we get into the spring, again, I just want to say, though, be careful during the holidays. Stay well and keep your families well. That's the important thing.
It really is. We'll look back on this, maybe not fondly, maybe in some ways. I know some of you have been really sick. We've had family members that have had it, and it really is a time to remember, hopefully, with some, some excitement as well as some sad feelings.
Now, we've been on this little theme of stories, telling different kinds of stories on IRS on the Road for the last several weeks. And we're going to continue with that today, and we're on part three of some travel stories. And I think it's either particularly inappropriate or particularly appropriate, depending on how you look at it, because none of us can travel very much right now. We're all looking forward, many of us, to travel once the pandemic is over. But travel is something to tell stories about, and travel is education in a way. And we've always felt, and I know many of you parents share this, and you grandparents, when you travel, if you do it right, it is powerful education. And when you can get children out of their comfort zone, out of their routine, out of their standard sort of paradigm, they start waking up to things. They start seeing possibilities. They start understanding that they're citizens of a much, much, much bigger world. And I don't know, we might have gone overboard on that.
I think we did. And I think before we start, we should say that Richard did have a job. I mean, a real job, a 9-to-5 job for a lot of years when we couldn't go anywhere.
Well, where I was traveling and you couldn't travel.
Well, and you were traveling. He was a political consultant all over the United States and Puerto Rico, and he was gone 4 days a week. And then there were times when he came back and did just have to go to the office, you know.
I know what you're doing. You're apologizing. You're saying, you know, some of the travel stories we're going to tell today are not typical. I mean, they're not things that most families would do. They're things we could do because later on in life we became full-time riders, and we found an interesting thing. We might as well just be honest about it. We found we got more riding done. If we were working on a book or we're working on a series of articles or whatever, we actually got more done when we weren't at home than when we were. So we traveled not only for educational reasons with the kids, we traveled because it helped us with our riding.
I know. I mean, a lot of times when I was riding, Richard would, one Christmas he gave me Wednesdays because he could be home with the kids for a few hours on Wednesdays. And that was fun because I really got to go out and sit in the van all day A couple of times I went to a motel so that I could really write and think. But this was really an unusual time in our lives when we really had a wonderful time.
But again, the theory was, if we can take our kids, if we can get them into new situations, it will expand their education. And we even had a motto for a while in our family: don't let school interfere with the kids' education. So some of the teachers, we were not their favorites because we were taking the kids out of school all the time. And we'd always say, hey, they'll write a theme on Bali or wherever we're going. And you know, will that work for you? And so we...
Well, I have to say there are some advantages to the COVID, because some of our kids have done a little bit of traveling, not on airplanes, but locally. We had a family that just did a 4-series national park tour of Utah, and just were in the car most of the time and totally isolated because the dad could work, the mom could work, and the kids could go to school.
Yeah, well, may be getting into a time where people have learned to work remotely in so many fields that people may have more chance to travel as families than ever before. And again, don't be dissuaded. We're going to sound like we're advocating that you travel more and more with your children. And in a way, we are. But don't be put off by the fact, well, it's too expensive, I can't do it. You know, we were thinking the other day, Linda, airplane travel is actually cheaper now.
Right now,
than it was
deals.
40 years ago. I remember when we were graduate students in Boston, we were looking for tickets that would get us back to Salt Lake City on a round trip for less than $600. And you can do it cheaper than that now.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
And one of the things that we have that makes travel so interesting now is Airbnbs. And the idea that when you go somewhere, you can actually live there for a few days. You're not in a hotel. You're not in some tourist place. You're living in a neighborhood. You're living in a building. You're living in a house. And that was our goal in traveling with our kids, was to try to get them to feel like, I've experienced living in Japan, or I've experienced living in England. I wasn't just a tourist. I was actually there. In many places, we put them in schools, and we tried to let them really have an experience.
Well, I think we'll start by just telling you that one of our main objectives at first was to get our kids out of our house, our really comfy house, and go. We were lucky enough to have a little property up in Oregon, and we bought it through a wild series of events and so on, but we thought, let's just take those kids up there for the summer, at least for, it was about 2 months. The first year, we went 2 different years, and we are just going to build a log cabin.
Well, you know, that story actually started at an amusement park called Lagoon, where there happens to be a little thing called Pioneer Village, and there was a cabin there that was actually the cabin of my great-great-grandfather, Sanford Bingham, and his father Erastus Bingham. And they raised, and the little cabin, the actual cabin they built, was transferred there, and now it's a tourist attraction. But we got fascinated with that house, that little cabin in which our ancestors raised 8 children. And we thought, wow, wouldn't it be something if we could give our children the pioneer experience of actually building a log cabin? Let's build one the same dimensions, the same size, the same loft, the same, and it wasn't very big. It was 16 by 16, had one big room and a loft. And so we had this property, like you said, Linda, in Oregon, and we went up there, and it took us 2 full summers, but we built a log cabin with our children. We cut the trees down. We built this cabin from the forest, and it was one of the great experiences of our whole life.
It was. Well, to be honest, we did have 40 logs brought in, right? But then we had to cut them down ourselves. Then we were going to sleep, you know, skinning logs. You know, when you pick raspberries and you're a kid, you go to sleep and all you can see is raspberries. All we could see was those logs we were skinning. But we had the best time. My greatest advantage was I'd never really camped out a day in my life, and I didn't know what I was in for, but we found
an old stove, a wood-burning kitchen stove. You baked muffins,
oh,
you cooked
so
on it.
Oh, we had so much fun, and those great fires.
We forgot how hard it was. All we remember is the good parts.
Campfires and so on. It was really amazing. parenting.
Now, we've illustrated what we're talking, these stories we're going to talk to you today. If you want to see pictures that go with the stories, just go on Instagram and go to Richard Linda Iyer, all strung together, Richard Linda Iyer, and there's 10 photos there. And the first one is Oregon, where we're in the Blue Mountains of Oregon in this primeval forest, building this log cabin with all of our children, all 9 of them. It was just an amazing experience.
Not looking our best.
Our
2-year-old looked like he'd been rolled in honey and then rolled in dirt. By 10 o'clock every morning, he was a mess.
The next story we wanted to share is one year we got the idea that we wanted to go live in Mexico. We actually thought the kids will learn Spanish if we just live in
Mexico
a summer.
Yeah.
And so we approached it a strange way. We're laughing at ourselves here. We thought, let's take a train down to Mexico. Let's go down by Guadalajara. And I had been there on a business thing a little bit earlier, and I had found a little town up by Lake Chapala, a beautiful little lake up above Guadalajara. And I had thought, wow, this would be such a great place. So we rented a little condo there, and we got on it. I remember our initial idea was we were going to drive down there. We loaded all the kids in our van. We drove to Tucson, Arizona, where we had some good friends, and we stopped off there for a couple of days. And they were horrified when they learned we were planning to drive all the way
in
to Guadalajara.
In those days, it was really scary. They said, no, you can't do that.
The banditos will get you.
So the bottom line is we got some tickets, and it cost more and took a lot more time.
Well, but we went on a train is the crazy thing. We decided, well, if we can't drive, we'll go on a train. And we got on a Mexican train. That was an experience like none other. We got Pullman cars, and the kids were bouncing around on these beds, and we finally made it to Mexico. But when we got there, Linda, what an experience to just live there for most of the summer and let our kids get acquainted with the kids in this village. And what a time we had.
We did. I think the thing our kids learned more than anything else is the neighborhood little kids came over and swam in our swimming pool, and that was the best exposure they had to Spanish, and they could barely speak 10 words by the time we went home. But it was so fun because this darling little girl had come every day in the same dress, and the last day they said, "You can jump in the swimming pool with us. Come on. And so wear your swimming suit tomorrow." So tomorrow she came back in the same dress and jumped in the swimming pool, and we realized she had no swimming suit, you know. And no shoes. And on the way home, we asked Sadie, what did you learn from that? And she said, I learned that you don't have to have shoes to be happy.
That's the kind of lessons you want your kids to learn when you travel.
Yeah.
Then, so the Mexico experience, we want to move. And by the way, if you're following this on Instagram, Richard Linda Iyer, the first picture is the Oregon experience. The second one is this Mexican experience. And the third one you're going to turn to, the third and fourth pictures, are Japan. And what a time we had in Japan. We had the opportunity one summer to live in Japan in a little town called Kamakura. And boy, did our children learn a completely different culture just by being there, making friends, going to Japanese schools.
We were welcomed by a wonderful woman whose husband was in Poland most of the time, but she invited us to their home. It was incredible that she did that, but we got into the schools. We had inside and outside shoes. We had so many experiences.
We learned the tea ceremonies. We went to Shinto shrines. We went to all sorts of
sand
Japanese
painting, flower arranging. This woman was amazing. We will never be able to thank her enough for that marvelous experience for us and for our kids.
And so pictures 3 and 4 on the Instagram page are of Japan. And then we're going to take a brief break. And when we come back, we're going to talk a little about building a nipa hut out of bamboo in Hawaii, and living for a little while in the Philippines. Again, trying to talk about travel stories to educate children in ways that nothing else can.
We'll be right back. Hang on.
Welcome back to Iyer's on the Road. Here's Richard and Linda Iyer.
And we're back talking to you about travel stories today on Iyer's on the Road. Not thinking that many of you will want to duplicate some of these stories because your circumstances and situations are different, but wanting to share with you the fantastic learning experience that it can be to travel with children. And you know, Linda, it's not only the children that learn. When you travel with your kids, I think parents learn more because you end up seeing things through your children's eyes. And children are incredible in terms of seeing and noticing and appreciating things that you would miss if you were just there by yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. It really is so fun to have the kids with us. It wasn't easy. I remember dragging all of our stuff along, sometimes sleeping bags and all the stuff that we needed. It was a little bit crazy, and each kid just had a backpack, and I had a lot of granola bars for when the kids wouldn't eat what we were eating there, but it was an amazing experience to travel.
So let me give you a little agenda for these next 10 minutes here. We're going to tell some stories about living in the Philippines, living in Peru, living in Europe, and living in Bali with our children. And if you are wanting to follow the illustrations on this, again, go to Instagram and go to our most recent post on Richard Linda Iyer, all strung together. And the next picture you'll see, number 5, is a picture from the Philippines. We spent some time there, but we also ended up on the island of Maui wanting to build a bamboo house. Now, you may say, what in the world were you thinking? Well, we'd had this experience of building a log cabin, and then it had occurred to us that, you know, the majority of the world doesn't live in... People in third world countries don't live in log cabins. They live in bamboo houses, the most common structure in the world where families live, if you were to do it numerically, is built from bamboo, especially in tropical climates. And so we had a friend that had some property that had a lot of bamboo on it, and we got the crazy idea that we wanted to spend some time there and build a bamboo house. And that was... The end result was not quite as the log cabin.
We did not get very far. We did get some concrete. We'd never used concrete before, so for some posts that would support. But they worked mostly on the floor, you know, bamboo cut in half.
We built walls.
Doing on the floor.
On the floor, and we built a roof and thatched the roof.
We did thatch the roof, yeah. But sadly, the first time we went back, which was 3 or 4 years later after that, the roof was gone.
A big wind had come. The log cabin lasted for 20 or 30 years. The Nipa hut that we built lasted for about 2 years.
Yeah, the fun story about the backstory on the log cabin is that now, this year, it fell over for the first time. It's been how many years?
30, oh, it's
35
been 30 years.
Eli was a baby when we were there. And it finally fell over, but our kids are going up every summer, and they are building the most fun things.
Because their childhood, part of their childhood.
So they take
a
sprinter full of kids. Last year it was 2 sprinterfuls of kids, and making slack lines and swings and tars and ropes and all kinds of crazy stuff that the kids have enjoyed. So we feel like that was a good investment.
Now, the next picture you're going to come to is Peru. It's Machu Picchu, which many of you have seen pictures of before. And we took the kids there for that wonderful hike up to Machu Picchu, and we spent some time there. And an amazing thing happened, Linda. One of our children named Noah, who was 15, thought it was the most romantic place he'd ever seen, and tell what he did.
Oh my goodness, he got to the top of that mountain, and you will see that in the Instagram. There's a big mountain there, it's about 2,000 feet above where Machu Picchu is. And he got up there and thought, oh, this is where I'm going to propose to my wife.
Someday when I fall in love.
He was 16.
Was he 16 or 15?
I think he was 16.
Okay.
Anyway, he found an old bottle and he put a message in it. It said, I like you more than a friend. Will you marry me? And he buried it.
Can you imagine a 16-year-old is planning when he meets the one he wants to marry, however many years it is, he's going to propose on top of Machu Picchu.
Okay, so we have to... Fast forward a lot of years, and by darn, that kid did it. It was amazing. We don't have time to tell you the details, but he got to the top, And it was amazing. This girl's like, what is going on? I wish we had time to tell you. But
he got her there under false pretenses, by the way.
He did. And then he got on his knee and proposed to her. And they are just so, such a great couple. It's a really fun story.
I guess the point there is that when your kids travel, they will return to those places. And we should mention, Linda, one of the great travel experiences, and many of you who are listening are members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and you know about missionary work. And we were lucky enough, and I really feel we were fortunate, that we were able to pick up all nine, well, 8 out of 9 of our children when they were done serving their 2-year missions. We picked them up and brought them home. But before we brought them home, we traveled in the place where they had worked, where they had labored.
And we took some kids with us.
And we took our other kids with us.
You can't necessarily do that now and for a while. It depends on the mission president, but most of them welcomed us. And we were so happy to see those kids surrounded by people who loved them dearly.
Yeah, that's the key. To see your son or daughter who's been a missionary and who's been doing humanitarian service and giving all they've got for God and for God's purposes and to help other people, to be there with them for a couple of weeks and to travel and to meet the people they've met and see where they lived and what they did, it's just a fantastic experience. And in our case, we were so fortunate because we did that in Bulgaria, we did it in Romania, we did it in Spain, we did it in England, we did it in Japan, we did it in Chile, we did it in Brazil. And every time was the younger kids or the other children seeing where their sibling had worked. So people say, how did all your children happen to go on missions? Honestly, I think part of it was they'd been to the mission field of their older siblings, and they saw what a powerful contribution they'd made. And I think that's what influenced the younger ones to also want to go.
It might have been. But again, everybody can't do that, especially
right
now. So we did have a wonderful time. I do have to say that one of the great learning experiences in travel for our kids, and this is more than travel because we were called to be, to preside over a mission in England, in London, when our kids were little. Our oldest was 5? 6,
I think, yeah. 5 or 6.
5 and a half,
yeah.
not quite 6, 5. And we had 4 kids. So we had a marvelous 3 years there, a magnificent time. We don't have time to go into that. 10 years later, we went back again because we were worried about the kids who hadn't had that experience, our little kids. And they just had a marvelous time, really, really loving the culture and really loving England. We've got England in our blood. In fact, we have a daughter living there right now who's been there for 5 years. And we go back often because it is part, we are British, really.
So we've ended
we
up...
We are, because we're relatives.
We've ended up living near London for 4 years now altogether, almost 4 years, 3 years on the mission, and then more than half a year one other time, and then back and forth and so on.
And you know, there's another thing that I don't think you have a picture of. Oh, gosh.
Well, pictures 7 and 8 are of Europe and England and living there with the kids. But
okay,
what did we
so
miss?
We missed Mount Kilimanjaro.
Oh, we missed the Africa trip.
We did. Yeah. We did have a marvelous time. It was because we did a humanitarian trip there anyway. And then afterwards, we went on a safari with the kids, which was beyond description. And then we went to climb Mount Kilimanjaro. And we should find a picture of that.
We will. And Linda, you know, I'm a little worried that listeners are thinking, wow, this is so unrealistic. No one could travel that much with their children. I wouldn't want to travel that much with my children and so on. But keep in mind, what we're suggesting is that our circumstances as writers and so on were a little different, that gave us some opportunities to travel. And we were also traveling with our books and doing book tours and speaking tours and so on. But the principle behind it, I think, is something that applies to everyone. And that is that when you can get your children out of their comfort zone and expose them to other cultures, it is a remarkable learning experience, and the cost of it is sometimes much less than you would imagine. And you have to learn to be an economical traveler. Some of our kids have gotten better at that than we are. For example, this Christmas, one of our daughters and her husband, they're instead of having a traditional Christmas with gifts and all the commercial aspect of it, I don't think she'd mind us saying this. They're going to Chile. They're flying to Santiago. They found an unbelievable bargain on tickets.
I think it was $200
round trip to Chile. And they're going to get in a car and they're going to drive down to Patagonia, one of the most beautiful parts of the whole world. Now you may say, wow, is that practical? Well, guess what? The total cost of that trip will be less than if they'd stayed home and had a traditional Christmas. So we're not trying to be travel advocates here as much as we are saying, don't eliminate the, no matter what your economic circumstances is, don't automatically say, oh, I can't travel with my kids, it's too expensive, because actually it isn't. And again, like you pointed out earlier, Linda, you don't have to go to Santiago, Chile. You can get in your car and travel down into some rural areas you've never been in. There's all kinds of ways to make travel work as an education.
Absolutely. And we did when sorry.
When
we traveled, we did often take books with us.
Yeah.
From school, and usually it was not during school time. Most of this is done during the summer.
Except for when we lived in
England for 3 years and then went back for another 6 months and put the kids in school. But it was really a remarkable experience, and we are truly blessed. We understand that. But you don't really need a whole lot of money to do all that.
So the last two photos on the Instagram, again, Richard, Linda, Iyer, if you want to follow along with these pictures, are from Bali in Indonesia. And we ought to end there, Linda, because we fell in love with the island of Bali. Now, it's a perfect prototype of a place with a culture so different that you feel like you're on a different planet. You feel like you're in a different world. And we had been there to do some speaking and so on. We fell in love with it. We brought our kids back with us. The last couple of pictures are of Bali. And we learned so much there from the artistic sort of spiritual orientation of the people who lived there. And the bottom line is we fell in love with it so much that we started bringing things home. We actually got an ocean container and shipped back a lot of the artifacts and the beautiful carvings and the beautiful wood, ironwood and other things. And we ended up building a house, our dream house, the house we'd always wanted to have, is essentially a Balinese house.
Well, actually, this is the other end of our travel, because our kids were now grown up, maybe Charity, our baby, was there just before she left for school, but most of them were all gone.
They were all gone.
But
we brought them back.
We have a funny story.
We sold our house.
About that. We sold our house where all the kids had grown up, and they had been saying, no, don't sell the house, don't sell the house. So one time we sold the house, and then I said, listen, we have a great idea. Okay, we're going to call the kids.
We got some good news and some bad news.
This is what we're going to say. We have good news and bad news. The bad news is we sold the house. The good news is we're going to go to Bali with some of the money.
We're going to use the profit from selling that house to take you all to Bali. You're going to get babysitters, leave your kids at home, and we're just going to go with you adult children and have 2 weeks in Bali.
It was hilarious. Like, we don't care about the old house. We're great. We're going. And we had the best time of our lives. It was an anniversary for us, and it was a great celebration.
And that's the other kind of travel we want to advocate. You parents who are older now, and you want to take your older kids when you have a chance somewhere unique. Don't take them to some resort. Take them to somewhere where they can really learn and just be together with them and leave the grandkids home.
So get out there as soon as the pandemic's over and travel. We thank you for bearing with us through this journey, and we know that you have your own way of travel, but we love you and we thank you for listening.
Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next week. We'll tell some Christmas stories.
And so hang in, and we'll see you next time.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.